Dustin Hoffman broke my heart last week. Dustin Hoffman broke my heart because when I think about sexual harassment, sexual assault, I can easily imagine a man like Harvey Weinstein, a man like Donald Trump, the classic stereotype of male chauvinist, predator, grabbing women in a violent way, walking around with their disgusting sense of entitlement. These are the men we want to punch in the face. These are the men we want to put in jail. We want to educate them, Kendrick Lamar kind of style. Sit down, bitch, be humble. Sit down, be humble. But as more and more brave, courageous women are sharing their stories, sad stories about sexual harassment, sexual assault, and you start hearing about men like Kevin Spacey, Louis C.K., Dustin Hoffman, it breaks my heart because it makes me think, am I a sexual predator? Are we, all of us men, are we all potential sexual offenders? And I'm not comparing, it's a huge spectrum of sexual violence, and I'm not comparing one incident of being offensive or insensitive to a lifetime of being a serial rapist and walking around the way others do. But nevertheless, these men, good men, men with emotional intelligence, confessed in sexual misconduct. I mean, whatever happened to the 11th commandment, thou shalt not rape, okay? I've read the 10 commandments. I mean, stupid stuff are inside the list and rape is out. I mean, like, don't work on, I work on Saturdays, okay? I mean, it's no biggie. I prefer not to, I have two kids to support. I mean, come on, dude, I need to, but you compare like working on Saturday into raping, do not rape is not on the list. I want to change that. I want to bring this notion of just let's reprioritize ourselves. And yeah, do not kill, cool, do not steal, important, do not rape, okay? It's very important. And as I were, you know, I was thinking, are all of us potentially rapists? And I think we know, and this is very sad, we know that deep inside, that's what Hannah Arendt told us, that's what the history told us. You can take the most generous, delicate person, the sweetest soul, and turn them into a killing machine. All you need is the right political atmosphere and the socialization. Okay? If you socialize a person that they are superior to others, and they are just being good citizens by harming others, okay? If you raise me up into believing that Palestinians are not equals, I went to military combat unit when I was 18, okay? I'm an Israeli Jew. This is Germany, okay? So if you socialize a child from young age to think that other people are inferior because they're Jews or Muslims or people of color or LGBTQ or refugees, they will grow into having the capacity of harming others, of objectifying them, of seeing them as disposable people. And the same way you can take the sweetest, delicate person and turn them into a killing machine, you can turn us all into sex offenders. Because nowadays, the socialization into manhood, I mean, you take a boy at the age of 4 or 5, and he starts hearing his father, his coach, his older brother saying, why are you crying like a girl? You're playing like a girl, you're fighting, you're running, you're doing something like a girl, and that's the biggest insult ever. Okay? When women still are making less money than men, holding less power positions, less leadership positions. When hardcore porn, when men are demolishing women as a sexual behavior, is viewed on every cellular phone every day by almost every child since the age of 11. What do we expect them to be at the age of 18? Okay? Every 14, 15, 16-year-old boy nowadays can walk into this room and instantaneously, within a second, classify each and every female into their porn category. Inside their minds, they can do that without even wanting, okay? And we need to understand the critical mass. When a sense of entitlement and men holding power position over women and the pornographic scope combine, that's the critical mass that generates sexual assault and sexual harassment, okay? And a large part of my job is to teach young boys how to not be douchebags, okay? We wanna raise the next generation of men and women to not be douchebags, not be assholes, just be equal, be a good human being, be generous, make others feel, you know, safe and valued. And the whole ELSE method, the eye-level sex education method, is a very blunt one, okay? We do stuff in a very blunt way. I'll give you an example. So I'm entering a class, okay? And the kids are like kind of anxious because they were told some guest speaker will come and talk to them about porn, sexuality, everything that nobody wants to speak about, what we need to. And I'm going like, hi kids, my name is Ran Gavrieli. No need to be polite, no need to raise your hand. We're doing very simple stuff. So I'm drawing three columns on the blackboard, okay? And I'm gonna write a title to each column. And every time I write a title, I want you kids, without raising your head, without anything, just shout at me, yell, say out loud whatever comes to your mind, okay? The first connotation you got. And the first column, I'm writing a man, and I'm asking kids, what makes a man? And they start saying to me, he's strong, he's fearless, he's brave, he's good at sports, he's a womanizer, he makes a lot of money, he's a boss, he's a leader, and so forth. And basically, it sums down to understanding manhood through power, okay? Three kinds of power. Physical power, if you're violent, aggressive, not afraid of fighting, good at sports, that's physical power. Financial power. If you make a lot of money, you can be a total geek. You can be, I don't know, Zuckerberg, Bill Gates. You're cool. You're a man because you make a lot of money. And the third power is sexual power over women. If you have sex with many, many women, you're among the alpha males. Okay? But it's basically about power. So then the next column, I'm writing a woman. I'm asking kids, what makes a woman? And they give you the most horrible, you know, answers. She's pretty, she's delicate, she wears pink, she likes to wear makeup, she goes to shopping, she drives you, she's your mom, she takes you to school, she takes you to soccer practice. I mean, but it basically narrows down into either a depiction of a stay-home mom or a Disney princess, which are both, I don't know, come on. Dude, no, okay? And in the third and most important column, I'm writing down a good human being. And I'm asking kids, okay? What makes someone a good human being? How do we know that someone is a good human being and not a shitty person? How can we tell that? And kids are saying immediately, they're generous, they're kind, they're gentle, they're not offensive, they will share with you, they care, you can talk to them, they're honest, you can listen to them, you can count on them, they're friendly, they're loving, they're caring, so on and so forth. So when we're done writing everything on the blackboard, time and time again, without any exception, the result is crystal clear and tremendously said that being a man in our culture has nothing to do with being a good human being. Being a woman, yes. Being a woman, the definition of woman in the eyes of kids is overlapping a bit the definition of good human being, mainly through motherhood, because motherhood is associated with sublime virtues of caring, nourishing, loving, okay? So being a woman does overlap to some extent. Being a man, it's the total opposite. Not even one word, okay? And this is where we should start. I truly believe we should start by raising our boys and girls into understanding manhood as similar as possible to being a good human being. What makes a man? He's generous, he's kind, you can count on him, you can talk to him, okay? He's honest, he's loving. That's the true definition. Thank you. And the thing is that we need to comprehend the magnitude, because 100% of all women are being sexually harassed. There isn't one woman in this audience out there in the world that hasn't been sexually harassed. But not 100% of men are sexually harassing. Not at all. Basically, it's something like 15%, okay? So it's more or less every seventh man. But I once saw the fabulous Tony Porter standing in front of an audience of students, just spreading his large, generous arms and saying, imagine my arms are all the men in our world. Something like that, 80-85% are actually good men. 85% of us are not raping, not assaulting, respecting women. So it's something like 15% of us men that making 100% of all women sexually harassed, assaulted, feeling unsafe, and another sizable amount of men harassed, assaulted, unsafe by other men. And us, the good 80-85%, we need to make a stand. We cannot be bystanders. You know what Dante said, what Martin Luther King said later, the same thing. The hottest place in hell is for those who maintain neutrality in times of moral crisis. There is no neutral, okay? You need to make a stand. And I think that, especially as parents, when we grow kids, we need to make a stand on a daily basis, and it's in the simple stuff, we just need to be aware. Okay, I'll give you a very simple example from just a couple of weeks ago. I'm visiting a couple of friends of mine, and this couple, it's a very cute couple, good people, intelligent, kind people, and they have a 3-4-year-old boy, okay? And I'm at their place, and I don't know, maybe because he's a boy, we're playing with a ball, okay? And so the three of us, his mom and dad and I, just playing ball with him, and I mean, the kid has like, zero eye-leg coordination, okay? It's not like that, I mean, just imagine it's a small 4-year-old boy, a huge rubber football, you throw it at him and he's like, and the ball is just passing, okay? It's not even close, I mean, come on, okay? And after like 5, 6, 7 times, it was so unrewarding, so he just left us three at the living room and went to pick another toy, something else. And we are standing there, you know, his mom is dead and myself, good friend of mine. He's in his room, we hear him, you know, the noise of picking some other toy. And his father, a very sweet friend of mine, without even noticing, is becoming like this. Please, God, not the doll and the stroller again. Just not the doll. Just please, enough with the doll. Enough. What does the kid come out with? Yeah, you got it. He's coming with this baby doll in a stroller, and he's like super sweet. I mean, come on. And he's walking with the stroller, and he's stopping because he's giving the baby doll a bottle. And he continues to walk with the stroller, and then he stops again because he has to cover his baby doll with a blanket. And in this specific moment, what shouts through the minds of the mom and dad in the room? Go ahead, say it. The kid is gay. I'm raising a gay child. I'm not going to have grandkids because I need to do something about having a gay child. We need to do something. And you look at them and say, I don't know, I'm a heterosexual person. I think being gay is fabulous. I think I wish I was like bisexual, because if you're bisexual, it's like double the option. It's a bigger market. I think it's beautiful. I mean, I don't have any advantage. I mean, let's just understand that it's amazing. But they're so afraid. I mean, come on, what's the worst thing that can happen if you let your boy play with dolls? The most awful thing ever that will happen is that he will grow into being a good enough parent. He will be the kind of father that stays home a while on parental leave. The kind of father that knows how to change a diaper. The kind of father who wakes up at 3 a.m. to give a bottle, even if your partner for life, she is nursing most of the day. Just wake up at 3 a.m., give him a bottle, change the diaper. Be a good parent. That's the worst thing that can happen. But within their mind, it is so scary. So they took away his dolls. I'm not kidding you. And he has a ton of basketballs, footballs. He doesn't want to play with them. They gave him trucks. They're buying a lot of trucks. Okay? He also has tanks and G.I. Joes and rifles. I mean, what the fuck? I mean, no, taking care of a baby is wrong, and raising him up into believing in occupation and tanks and rifles. I mean, what the hell is that? And the thing is, I think this is a better way for us to start raising another generation, more equal, just allowing boys and girls the whole spectrum of identities. You can play with a small kitchen and play with balls. You can play with dolls and you can play with trucks. You can wear both pink and blue, and it is wonderful and it is okay. This is where we should start with, okay? Educating and raising the next generation, not to be douchebags, but to be equals and loving and caring and understanding that masculinity should be similar to being a good human being. That's the whole idea. May the force be with us. Thank you.